I'm going to concentrate on biserial correlation. What is the biserial? The name itself you can find of the biserial. So bi plus serial correlation. Therefore, we have the two variables needed for doing a biserial correlation also. One variable it may be a dichotomous, other variable should be in a continuous nature. Therefore, the term serial represent variable. So here the term serial represent it's like a continuous. So for doing a biserial, we need two variables needed. One variable continuous format. So continuous in the sense we already know in the scales of measurement. That's a four scales of measurement. One is called nominal, ordinal, and interval as well as the ratio. In the case of this, continuous means the variable may be a interval or ratio. The other variable should be artificial dichotomy. So normally in the nominal scale only we can divide into the category. The nominal scale we can go with the number of category. But the dico represent only two classifications. If the nominal data or nominal variable having only the two divisions, then it's called as a artificial dichotomy. So it's called a dichotomy. So in the dichotomy, there is a two classifications. There one is called natural dichotomy, other one is called artificial dichotomy. That things I may highlight now. Before that, why the biserial correlation is needed? That things I may highlight now. What is the biserial correlation? What is need for this? So actually, the biserial correlation is to estimate the relationship between a continuous variable as well as the dichotomous variable. So I already mentioned that. So we need a two variable for doing a correlations. So it's like a bivariate correlation only. For doing a biserial correlation, we need a two variable. One is called continuous. It's nothing but interval or ratio. Other variable, it should be a dichotomous, nothing but a nominal. But di means two. So the term di represent two only. If the only two fold classifications happen in a nominal data or nominal variable, then it's called dichotomous variable. The term dichotomous means cut into two parts or divided into two categories. For example, I'm taking as a gender. If you're taking as a gender, only two classifications are the male and female. If you're categorizing the any nominal variable into only two classifications or two categorical things, then it's called as a dichotomous. I hope you understand dichotomous. So normally the term dichotomous means cut into two parts or divided into two categories. This reductions into two categories may be a consequence of the nature of data obtained. So for example, in the study to find out whether or not a student passes or fails a certain standard, we place a crucial point dividing a pass and fail students anywhere we please. Hence, the measurement in the variable is reduced to two categories as a pass and fail. You hope I understand. Suppose I'm conducting the examinations. Based on your achievement, I have to categorize. So your mark is maybe continuous. Your mark of your the examination may be continuous data. But I want to classify that the continuous variable or continuous data into a nominal. What I have to classify, I can divide into pass student as well as fail students. I can fix what is the cutoff for the pass, what is the cutoff for the fail. So I am going to fix some artificial way. What is the percentage of pass, what is the percentage of fail. So that is called as the artificial dichotomous. Here there is no naturally divisions, or naturally we could not be divide the things. Artificially I am dividing the group in a continuous group in a discontinuous or discrete manner. Therefore it's called artificial. Now I'm moving to the one more definition of dichotomous. The dichotomous variable can be either discrete or true or natural dichotomy. So the same, we can use this natural dichotomy in a different name: discrete dichotomy, true dichotomy, or a natural dichotomy. So all is same only. Other pair of other dichotomy is called continuous or artificial. So here normally we are talking about these two only. Natural, what is the natural dichotomy? Artificial dichotomy. So based on the natural and artificial dichotomy, we can select the statistics also. We could not be select in a blind manner as a point biserial or a biserial. So based on the variable only we have to select. I am already mentioned that for doing a biserial, we need two variables. One variable is a continuous nature. Other variable should be discrete, as nothing but a dichotomous. I hope my voice is audible, is clear. If you are not, my voice is not audible in the sense, kindly check your internet connection. Yes. Now the natural and discrete dichotomous or male or female. See here, I'm talking about the natural and discrete dichotomous. Both are same only. It means that we easily categorize the group in a twofold, but in a natural way. Here we could not fix any kind of some standard rule. We can classify male and female. Naturally, they are male and female. We can easily classify. For example, I have to divide the people. Those are blanks to Tamil Nadu. Those are blanks to the Kerala. So we can easily classify, because based on the birth, we can easily find out that it is called naturally. We can easily find. Okay, that kind of thing is called as a natural dichotomy. That's why I'm highlighting the term male and female. Then like only two possibilities are there. There is no underlying continuum between. For example, there is no male and female in between. No one is there. Okay, we can easily classify male and female. Even if you go with the transgender also, it won't be dichotomous, because it comes to the third category. So therefore, I already mentioned the dichotomous only two-fold classifications. If you come for the third classification, it's not the dichotomous. I think Prasanna can understand. Transgender means there's a three classification becomes. Therefore, that variable is not a dichotomous. I'm talking about in our classroom. Suppose if you are taking the population that is transgender is coming. I'm talking about in our MIT classroom, only two groups are there. So I can divide the groups into two, how male and female. There is no transgender. Therefore, once I take as your classroom as a sample, I can get only the two groups. I'm dividing the groups into two. That is called dichotomous way. That is called male and female. That is called natural dichotomy. I am not doing any manipulation with this. But if I go with the same classroom, instead of dividing male and female, I'm dividing the group of your class as a pass and fail. That is called artificial. What I'm doing here, I can check, I can fix some mark. For example, I'm fixing those who are getting more than 50, they are the pass. Those who are getting lower than 50, they are fail. So like that, I am fixing here as a teacher, as an investigator, then I am dividing the group into two groups in an artificial manner. So it is also a dichotomous, but it's not a natural dichotomous, it is a artificial dichotomous. I hope you get it. So because there is a continuous, there is a score. For example, I am dividing the pass and fail, no? That score, it may be continuous data. For example, the students may get the score from 30 to 100. So the scores may be continuous. I am dividing for research purpose. I am dividing the continuous scale in a discrete manner, or in a nominal manner, or in a categorical manner with two classification like pass and fail. So therefore, if you are continuous or artificial dichotomous, are those which we assign there to be an underlying continuum. There's a continuum may be there, but we assign individual to a category based on some orbital criterion. Example, artificial dichotomy or pass or fail. See here, there's an example I'm given. There's a pass or fail. How we can fix pass or fail in the sense artificially we are fixing. There is no thumb rule for fixing the pass and fail. What way we are fixing? Based on some cutoff score or any test, or for example, I want to divide a short and tall. I had to fix who is a short, who is a tall. I had to fix some kind of norms. I have to fix some arbitrary. Then only I can divide who is short, who is to be taught. This is called artificial. This is called artificial. I hope you understand. When you classify the group in a natural order, it means that there is no continuum. There is no underlying continuum is there. We can easily classify the data in a natural way, like male and female, rural and urban, because we already know, sir, who is the rural urban background students, urban background students. We can easily get the data. But if you go with taking a CA artificial dichotomous, the investigator or any people can divide the groups into two in some categories. For example, in the research and all, the people are collecting the age. Age is a variable. When they go for age as a variable, what they're doing, they're categorizing the variable in, say, below 30 and above 30. What it means, the students, the samples, age may be 25 to 100 or 25 to 80. There is a continuous data, but the purpose of the research, what the research are doing, they divide the group into two classification in a dichotomous mode. One is called below 30 or below 35 age, above 35. So when you divide the age into two categories based on your convenient in an artificial manner, then it's called artificial dichotomous. I hope all of you get it. And also understand the difference between the natural dichotomous as well as artificial dichotomous. You can type in the chat box. Natural means naturally it made. We can divide it without any kind of standard norms. we don't fix any kind of cutoff on that. It may default, we can easily divide the group. That is called an action dichotomous. I will highlight some of the examples and you may easily get it. This is an example of dichotomous. See this image. First, I'm going to talk about the natural dichotomous. For example, male, female. It's naturally male and female. Living, dead. So it means that those who are living the world, they are liver. Those who are dead, they are not dead. There is in between, no one is there. In between, no one is there. Those who are having the own home, those who are not having the own home. So no one can be having the partial home. So we could not be divide the variable in some continuous way. Being a farmer. So we in the data also we are dividing that who is a farmer, who is not a farmer. Then being a PhD, it's like a degree. Those who are having the doctorate degree, they are called PhD. Those who are not having the doctorate degree, they are not as not being a PhD. We are not checking the pursuing the PhD. Only whether you are qualified PhD or not qualified PhD. So we have to easily, naturally we can divide the group. The living in Delhi or living not living in Delhi. This is called natural dichotomy. I hope you understand. This is called natural dichotomy. These are things natural dichotomy. But if you go with artificial, there is a continuous order. For example, I'm taking this socially adjusted, socially mal adjusted. So in between also there is an order. So I can divide one mark. I'm collecting some data. From the data, I'm going with above 30. Above 30 is called a socially adjusted. Below 30 is called as a socially adjusted, mal adjusted. Like that, I'm dividing the group in an artificial manner. See the next exam, very clear example, I'm talking poor and not poor. So how we can classify the poor, not poor? We have to fix some norms. Those who are having this salary less than 100 or less than 1000 per day, they are called as they are poor. Those are getting more than 100, they are called as not poor. We have to categorize the some artificial way, then we can classify the people. Then dropout, saying successful and accessible. Successful and accessible is based on the mindset. So in between there's a continuous order is there. So this kind of continuum variable we are dividing into two. So even the pass fail, for example, of one exam I make it is a 45 SCA pass. The next exam I can take is a 40 SCA pass mark. So I can classify, I can divide the group also. I can fix the thumb rule, which is a pass, which is a fail. So based on this, I can classify the people. I hope you may understand what is the artificial as well as the natural dichotomy. Those who understand this one, kindly type in the chat box. Yes. Parallel, I'm giving some definitions also. While natural dichotomy occurs with variable which naturally may assume only two possible states, but artificial dichotomy can create it simply by comparing interval scale. I already mentioned that it may be controlled. It may be continuous data. But for our purpose, we may classify into two. So see this case, for example, all folks being older than 40 years will get assigned as a value of one, otherwise first group. All others are values here, second group or zero. In this manner, we can categorize the group. Now I'm going back to these things may comes for the examinations. When we can use the point biserial or biserial correlation. Now we are talking about the point serial only. There is a small difference between the point biserial and biserial. See here, the biserial is common to all the correlation. Only the other correlation having the point biserial. So next time we'll talk about what is a point biserial. But now we are talking about the biserial only. There is a condition we can apply a biserial as well as the point biserial. For biserial, our one variable, we already told, no? So we have one variable should be a dichotomous. Other variable to be continuous nature. That one variable in a dichotomy should be artificial. It means that it may be pass or fail or socially adjusted or not socially adjusted, that kind of variable. So if you found male and female, you could not be used for biserial. So what is the condition for biserial? We need a two variable. So for doing a biserial, we need a one variable as a continuous data. One variable is a continuous. Other variable should be a dichotomous, so it should be a dichotomous. But the dichotomous should be a natural. It should be a natural. So I hope you understand. For example, I'm going to give some example. I'm dividing this here. I'm putting as a mark like achievement. Like I'm putting as a achievement. Your achievement mark. Your achievement mark of. I'm taking as a achievement mark of some subject or whole subject achievement as a continuous. Get the continuous. But in the dichotomous, I'm taking is a pass and fail. Pass and fail of your previous semester. Pass and fail about the previous semester. This is for the new semester. Achievement, I'm checking the new semester, but the pass and fail of the previous semester I'm taking. So I am checking the previous semester, those who are pass, I can check with the achievement scores. Parallel, I'm checking those who are fail in the last examination, how the achievements comes now. So I'm going to compare. For this, I'm using a bi-serial correlation. But if you go with point bi-serial, the same way, we have the two variables needed. One variable I already mentioned that should be continuous. It should be continuous. But the second variable should be dichotomous. But the second variable dichotomous should be natural, like male and female, rural and urban. That is should be there. So I hope you understand. This is not natural. So this is called dichotomous. This is called artificial. Yeah. So biserial for artificial. Biserial for artificial. Biserial for artificial dichotomous. But in the point biserial, it should be a natural dichotomous, like male female. Like male female. Suppose in this case I'm giving the example how the male female associate with our relationship with the achievement score. So I'm giving you say achievement score as an example, like achievement score as an example. So I hope you understand. Achievement score is a continuous variable in the point by serial. In the dichotomous of IPCT, I'm taking say male and female. In this case, we can go with point by serial. If you found the variable like pass and fail in one dichotomous, other variables are achievement. Achievement is a continuous, we know. But here, see here, the dichotomous of this variable, it's an artificial base. Therefore, we can adopt a biserial only. We cannot move for point biserial. So this question composite may come to the net exam. Be aware of it. When you found the two variable, one is continuous, other variable is a dichotomous, but in artificial, you can go with biserial. Now, this is a formula for biserial. Normally, we use the term biserial, RBIS. So I hope you understand that term. This is called RBIS, the short form. When you go for, other is a representation. When you go for the Pearson product moment correlation, we are using a small r. When you go for the rank correlation, we are using the term rho. Apparently, when you're highlighting the biserial correlation, we can use the symbol as here, RBIS. So, it's nothing but relationship, otherwise a biserial correlation relationship. The formula is called MP minus MQ divided by sigma. These things we already know. Sigma is nothing but the standard deviation of the entire group. P and Q is for the proportion of the first group. Second, Q for the proportion of the second group. I already mentioned, no? We need a two dichotomous. For example, P represent pass group, Q represent fail group. The fail group means score. This for the pass group mean score. This for the fail group mean score. Therefore, we have the two mean scores: pass group as well as the fail group. Then the standard deviation for the whole group. Then the pass group proportion, the fail group proportion, divided by y is nothing but ordinate height. So in the normal quadratic curve, we are talking about the ordinate curve, height. So that's we had to find it from the table that I will highlight when we go, come for the calculation. I hope you understand. R biserial. Biserial are MP and MQ represent mean of the first group and second group, otherwise the mean of the first dichotomous category, second dichotomous category say M2, it should be artificial. P and Q is a proportion. Then Y represent the ordinate, sigma represent the standard deviation. So I hope you understand this formula. Now I'm directly moving to the sum. See here, this is sum. Actually the sum part is not needed for the examination part. Only the theoretic input is needed, but for the higher education, when you go for as a teacher, it may need for you. For that, I am going to be highlight. The questions may become like this. So sometimes they may give the biserial correlation directly. Otherwise, you can check from the table itself which correlation you have to adopt it. See here, there is a question. The following scores of achievement of trained group and untrained group. Therefore, we have the two groups. Achievement is a one variable. It's like a continuous variable. The trained group, so I am taking one group as the achievement test. We have the another group is called, another variable is called this one. So untrained group, then trained group. So this is our variable. This is called dichotomous. So but the trained and untrained is only artificial. How we can classify the trained and untrained? Based on the artificial, we can highlight that, we can fix that. This much of getting the trained, they are called as trained people. those who are not getting anything of any, for example, I am going to divide the ICT train. If anyone attend any training program of ICT, they are called trained people. Those who are not getting the any kind of training related to ICT, they are called untrained. Here I am classifying the people based on the investigator needs. So I am classified as an investigator classified in an artificial manner, therefore it's called artificial dichotomous. So in this case, we can adopt only the bicerial. So I hope you understand why we have to use the bicerial in the sense. We have two variables, but the one variable is a continuous, but other variable in a dichotomous, but in the artificial manner. But in the case of the last two classes, what we discussed in lesson one is called Pearson product moment correlation. In the Pearson product moment correlation, both the variables should be continuous. So this question may come to exam. If both the variable is continuous, you can go with Pearson product moment correlation. If both the variables in ordinal, in a rank format, you can go with rank correlation. If one variable is continuous, other variable is artificial dichotomous, we can go with the biserial. If the one variable is continuous, other variable is natural dichotomous, then you can go with the point biserial. These questions may come for next exam, be aware of it. Now, this is our group. This is our trained group, one group. This is our untrained group. So this score, what it represents the sense. For example, this is my achievement mark. This is the achievement mark. They given us a sum. This is the achievement score. 70-79, it's like a continuous. I already mentioned, no? One variable is a continuous nature. See here, 669, 50-59, 40-49, it's a continuous data. Therefore, one variable is continuous. We are checking that this variable is a continuous format. Time should be continuous. These two classification, trained and untrained, is a classification, two-fold classification in a dichotomous mode. What is three represent? Any people can tell what is the three represent? You can type in the chat box. This three represent the three trained, the three students of the trained group got the score 70-79. What is 7 represent? 7 students got the scores in between 70-79 in the untrained group. So the trained group, 3 students got the scores in between 60-69. 4 students in the untrained group got 60-69. The same way, 4 students in the trained group got 50-59. So like there is a classification, the data is there. This for total. So total is nothing but 3 plus 7, 10, 3 plus 4, this is trained and untrained people total, 4 plus 4, 8, 7 plus 9, 16, 4 plus 9, 13, 2 plus 9, 11, 2 plus 8, 10. This is a total of these trained and untrained group. I'm adding with the total also. This is a total of trained group, 25 students are there. This is a total of untrained group. This is a total of the BMP students. So it means the 75 students, the all the 75 students that we classified into trained and untrained. Now I'm doing the how to resolve it. We already know the formula. This is our formula, MP minus M2. So we need a mean scores of trained group. Here MP represent mean scores of the trained group. So then MQ represent the mean scores of the untrained group. Now sigma is nothing but the standard deviation of the entire group. The P is nothing but the proportion. So for example, P represent, we have the 25 students in a trained group out of 75 students. So this proportion is called P. Then Q is nothing but untrained students. We have 50 untrained students out of 75 students. This ratio is called Q. Y is for the ordinate. So the height, that's I would tell in the table. Now I'm do this solved in the solution. See here the solutions, they highlighted here. The solution I may highlight now. Now this is already there, the scores FFP and FQ is already there. So FP represent frequency, don't worry, FP is nothing but frequency. FQ represent the frequency of the untrained group. The same thing I'm writing, FT is a total frequency. So this area is already there. So this much area is already there in the sum, okay? So this area I didn't touch anything. So as it is, I'm writing here. Now we need a MP. What is the MP? So the MP is nothing but mean of the first group. We already know the formula for mean is equal to summation of, so we need the formula summation of F of capital X divided by N. So this is our formula. F means frequency, we know the frequency. We need the value of X. X is nothing but the midpoint. In the last section we were discussing about the midpoint. In this case, what is our score? This is score 70-79. The midpoint for 70-79, 74.5. How it comes in the sense? 79 plus 70 divided by 2 is equal to 74.5. So this value is 72. The same way, 69 plus 60 divided by 2, 64.5. 59 plus 50 divided by 2, 54.5. This is called x value. I hope you understand this x value. In down, every summations are the summations, everything. Yeah? Now I need to find a Px because we need a Fx divided by n. So for finding the mean, I can go with Fx. So Fb is nothing but this here p value. I am multiplying with this value. So this multiply for this value is equal to this value. So it's nothing but Fb into x is equal to Fbx. The same thing, the 3 into 64.5 is equal to 193. 4 into 54.5, 218. Then 7 into 44.5, 311.45. Then 4 into 34.5, 138. Then 2 into 24.5 is equal to 49. Then 2, 14.5, 29. So I hope you understand how it's coming. The same way, so now I find the Fx. Now we want to know the summation. That summation is called 1162.5. So therefore, we can easily find out Mp is equal to 1162.5 according to the formula, summation Fx, divided by n. N is nothing but this one, 25. Once you divide by 25, we get the answer 46.5. Therefore, we are finding the first value, Mp value we found is 46.5. Similarly, we can go with Mq. I am selecting another color to mark in this one. I am using this color. Yeah. So now, how we can find the Fq? Yes. So here, the formula for Fq is the same. Summation of Fx divided by n. But in this case, Fq means this is a 7. Then 7 into 74.5 is equal to 52.5. Then 4 into 64.5 is equal to 258. Then 4 into 54.5 is equal to 218. Then 9 into 44.5 is equal to 400.5. Then 9 into 34.5 is equal to 310.5. Then 9 into 24.5 is equal to 220.5. It's like a multiplication. 8 into 14.5 is equal to 116.6. That total 2045, therefore 2045 divided by 50 is equal to 40.5. I hope you understand how it becomes 40.5. Therefore, we are finding the MQ value also. We found MP and MQ. Next, we have to find MQ, that sigma value. The sigma value is nothing but, what is this sigma value is represented in the sense, standard deviation of the entire group. So, entire 75 students. I'm selecting the another color. Yeah. So how we can find out this one? For this we need Ftx, the whole is needed to find. Therefore the same way the 10 into 74.5, 74.5, 7 into 64.5, 45.5, 8 into 54.5, 46. Like that we can go with the total. In the total divided by 75, number of students is called 44.77. From that we are going with standard division, because we know the formula for standard division. Sigma is called root of summation fx squared divided by n. X is called this already knows that the difference x minus capital M. So x is nothing but this is a midpoint. Then capital X is a mean. Then M we already know is a mean. So here in this case we want to find the small x. Small x is called capital X. The capital X is nothing but our midpoint. Then the MT is nothing but our this total. So here what we have to do, we can go with the capital X minus 42.77. So 42.77, that's good. If you are the small x is nothing but here, we already know that that is called the difference between the integer scores as well as the mean. When you talk about in the standard division, we are using the term small x is nothing but a capital X minus capital M. So for this, if we apply, we may get that answer. So how I will tell you that 31.73 is coming in the sense. What is our x value? 74.5 is our x value. I'm less with the, so just I'm clearing this one, then it should be easy for you. Just I'm going back to the very solid, yes. So now I'm going to be at the next. So now see here, now I'm going to talk about the how this value is coming. So for this, we have to go with this x, x minus mt. What is our mt? So 42 point something, therefore 74.5. So we already know the value is 42.77 as the mt value. So what it comes, 74.5 minus 42.77, 31.73. Thus similarly, 64.5 minus 42.77, 21.73. 54.5 minus 42.77 is called 11.73. The entire total is come 12.11, the entire summations. Then if you know the summation, we know for the summation because we need only the f of x square. Right? So we are finding x, we need the x square, then fx square for finding the standard deviation. Therefore, I am finding the x square value parallel to fx square. Fx square nothing but this x square is nothing but x into x. So 31.73 into 31.73, 106.793, the same 21.73 whole square this one, 11.73 this one, like that this is a square. Now of particularly with the f. So what is our f in this, in the sense f total? So we have to multiply with the f total. It means that 10 into this value is equal to this value, then 7 into 472.1929 is equal to this one, then 8 into 137.59.29 is this value. Like that I multiplied, the final score comes 27,074.64. then we know the n value is nothing but 75, total 75. If you go with the sigma value, it comes 18.99. therefore I am finding this value also. Therefore we are finding mp, mq, sigma also. Now our task to be find p and q value. What is p value? P is nothing but proportion of the pass group. So the formula is n1 by n. n1 is nothing but this 25. Therefore 25 divided by number of students, 75 is called 0.33. similarly, n2 divided by n is equal to 50 minus 75 is called 0.67. therefore I found the p and q value also. Only the remaining value y. Y is nothing but ordinate. See here, it's called ordinate value. But for knowing the ordinate value, we need this p and q value. So just I'm checking the 0.33 and 0.67, which is the biggest one. It's called largest proportion 0.67. The lowest proportion is called 0.33. So now I'm going with the next table. The table is called ordinates corresponding the divisions. It will be available in the statistics book. There we can find the larger proportion, smaller proportion. So in our larger proportion 0.67, lowest proportion 0.33. therefore I'm taking the larger proportion 0.67. see here, the largest p as a 0.67, the lowest, the smallest parallelly what it comes 0.33. therefore satisfy this area. I'm marking this area. Yes, so the largest p is 0.67, our largest value proportion. The lowest is called 0.333. so if you go back, we may see that 0.3 is the lowest, 0.67 highest. We need a y value, is nothing but ordinate. So in this table, the ordinate value, this is our ordinate. So this is our y value. So I'm keeping another color. This is our y value. So 0.3621. 0.3621, it is our ordinate value. This ordinate value I am typing here as a 3 point, only 3 decimal only. So after finding this value, just I am going to be apply these things here. So 46.5 mp, mq 40.059 divided by sigma value 18.99 into p value 0.33 and q value 0.67 divided by y value 0.362 according to the table. Then if you multiply this area 6.41 divided by 18.99 into 0.221 into divided by 0.362, we can apply the Bodmer's rule to solve this one. Then finally we may get 0.337 into 0.61 is equal to 0.2. Therefore, the biserial value of this sum is called 0.02. But that already we know the that level, once we get the 0.2 as a correlation score, is called very low positive. Therefore, the interpretation for this in the trained and untrained group association or the correlation with our basically with the achievement score having the very low positive correlation, maybe positive, but it's very low positive correlations. I hope you understand how to solve this kind of biserial quotient correlations. Then we can use this kind of biserial correlation. There is a limitations also there. Normally, this kind of biserial R, we can use it for, so the formula page I'm showing. Normally, this kind of biserial R cannot be used in the regression equations because point biserial only we may use that one. Does not have any standard error estimates here. It's not limited, unlike R, to the range of ±1, 0, ±1. Then creates a problems in matching comparison with other coefficient of correlations. These are some of the limitations are there. But doing this kind of correlation, we need some assumption also. There's a 4 assumption may be satisfied for doing this kind of biserial. That first assumption is that continuity in the dichotomous strikes. That's why I told it's a artificial. So according to that, continuous means the dichotomous. One of the variable in the dichotomy, that variable we are adopting for doing this correlation. One variable we already told that it's a dichotomous, but the dichotomous should be near artificial. It means that continuity. The second one, normality of the distribution under and the dichotomous. I'm sure we are, normality becomes the second assumption. The third assumption for doing a biserial, the large N. So the sample size should be a big one. Then the fourth assumption is called a split near to the median. So normally we are dividing the group based on the median based on it. So these are the assumptions we have to think while doing a biserial correlations. Hopefully, this biserial correlations may be useful for you. If you have any queries, you can ask me now. So I hope you understand what is the biserial correlations. Once again, I can little summarize. I can go summarize very fastly. So for doing a point biserial, biserial correlations, we need, here is all this. See here, the biserial correlation, we need two variable. One variable is continuous, other variable is artificial dichotomy. Don't forget, it should be artificial dichotomy only if not a biserial. Similarly, in the case of the biserial, then we can use, in the sense I already highlighted, for summary, I'm going to highlight once again. Just I'm removing the ink now. Yes, see here. One variable should be continuous. According to this example, achievement score. Achievement score is a continuous. The artificial dichotomy is called trained group. Other one is called untrained group. So if you have the two variable like this, one variable continuous format, other one is the artificial dichotomy, then we can use the biserial correlation. So I hope you understand what is the biserial correlations and its applications. So thank you so much.